Thus, Marx summarized the phenomenon he dubbed alienation. That is, the state of social, mental, and productive disharmony that exists when the basic social expression of humans, as well as the only concrete link humans have to their reality, their labor, is utilized with instruments which the worker does not own, produced to a design which he did not formulate, and given up to a proprietor whose exchange, the wage, does not satisfy, and indeed whose proportional value to that of the worker's labor from which he is estranged is but a fraction. Marx begins, unlike so many, from the supposition that man lived for the vast majority of his history in a form of primitive communism, that is, hunter-gatherer society, where, in no conception of private property or control over the means by which individuals reproduce themselves, eat, clothing, etc., by any individual exists, sociologist Richard Lee explains. Before the rise of the state and the enrichment of social inequality, people lived for a millennia in small-scale kin-based social groups, in which the core institutions of economic life included the collective or common ownership of land and resources, generalized reciprocity in distribution of food, and relatively egalitarian political relations. The basic nature of humans, our sense of community and solidarity, which characterize early human history, is expressed, according to Marx, by our productive power. And when this productive power is used not to fulfill our sincerest wish of producing for the good of ourselves and for those we care about, but to make the cheapest good for the lowest wage possible, and worse, to fetishize commodities, which we no longer recognize as our labor, but as things separate from us with their own social power and symbolism, i.e. clothing, cars, jewelry, just to name a few obvious examples. Thus, justifying the religious term fetishism, we are not only alienated from our natural social state, but reproduce and perpetuate unknowingly the process of exploitation, alienation, and fetishism of commoditized labor by existing in a state of a producer who must also consume to reproduce oneself in a stratified capitalist society, which makes us not only blind to the greater mechanism at work, but perverts our relationship with others and directly damages, as I will show, our very physical and mental health. Since the discovery of the peptic ulcer, medical science has been acutely aware of the causal link between stress and negative health. It is universally accepted that chronic stress can be responsible for such desperate conditions as irritable bowel syndrome and heart attacks, to chronic headaches, weight gain, depression, and much more, common signs and symptoms of stress. So powerful is the biological response to perceived stimuli that in 1967 the UK government commissioned a report led by Dr. Michael Marmot to investigate the social determinants of health. The two Whitehall cohort studies collected data on some 28,000 British civil servants and studied the effects of the regimented and highly stratified nature of the service on the health of its bureaucrats. The findings were interesting, to say the least. According to the study's lead researcher, Michael Marmot, the first study began in 1967, showed a steep inverse association between social class and assessed by grade of employment and mortality from a wide range of diseases, picking up where Whitehall 1 left off 20 years previous. In the time since, Whitehall 2 found that there had been no diminution in social class differences in morbidity. We found an inverse association between employment grade and prevalence of angina, electrocardiogram evidence of ischemia, and symptoms of chronic bronchitis. Self-perceived health status and symptoms were worse in subjects in lower status jobs. The findings go even deeper. Not only were those in the descending ranks of the service more likely to drink and smoke, obvious methods for dealing with stress, but those in lower ranks also had slightly elevated body mass indexes, higher cholesterol, a greater likelihood of reporting symptoms of depression, and no less than, in Whitehall 2's assessment, three times the mortality rate of the highest ranked administrators. Those in the lower ranks also had elevated levels of problematic stress hormone cortisol. One of the blunter points made in the Whitehall report is that jobs characterized by low control, low opportunity to learn and develop skills, and high psychological workload are associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease. The Whitehall team is not the first to make this claim. Whitehall's identification of low control work environments as detrimental to health is echoed by a different study which appeared in the International Journal of Health Services in 1980. Which concluded that alienated labor, a lack of control over the work process, loss of product through appropriation, and the competitive and fragmented work relations, and the subjective dimensions of alienation, sense of powerlessness, dissatisfaction, and frustration, may be reduced as workers gain increased control over the process and product of their labor. This phenomenon of estranged labor creating in the labor an adverse state of health is observed by Marx when he says this. First, the fact that labor is external to the worker, i.e., it does not belong to his intrinsic nature, that in his work, therefore, he does not affirm but denies himself, does not feel content but unhappy, does not develop freely his physical and mental energy, but mortifies his body and ruins his mind. The worker, therefore, only feels himself outside his work, and in his work, feels outside himself. He feels at home when he is not working, and when he is working, he does not feel at home. Its alien character emerges clearly in the fact that as soon as no physical or other compulsion exists, labor is shunned like the plague. External labor, labor in which man alienates himself, is a labor of self-sacrifice or mortification. Lastly, the external character of labor for the worker appears in the fact that it is not his own, but someone else's, that it does not belong to him, that in it he belongs, not to himself, but to another. Just as in religion, the spontaneous activity of human imagination, of the human brain and the human heart, operates on the individual independently of him. It is the loss of himself. The effects of capitalism and subsequently estranged labor are as present in the home as they are in the workplace. Many in the West, though their numbers are declining somewhat, believe that excessive contact and attention will spoil a child and make them less independent. These attempts to make our children individualistic and independent are not only misguided, but ensure that the cycle of alienation not only affects those work lives are miserable and stressful, but that their children are subjective to comparable mechanisms of dysfunction. It cannot be otherwise, as in society whose values are of independence and whose effect is alienation. We make our children clones of ourselves, alienated in distance. Dr. Gabor Mate explains. Ferberization seems simple. After about 1 week, your infant will learn that crying earns nothing more than a brief check from you and isn't worth the effort. She'll learn to fall asleep on her own without your help, reads Dr. Ferber's advice. The question is, what else does the baby learn when treated this way? And what is the impact of such learning? People cannot consciously recall what they learned from the first year of life because the brain structure that stores narrative memory are not yet developed, but neuropsychological research has established that human beings have far more powerful memory system imprinted on their nervous systems called intrinsic memory. These emotional memories may last a lifetime without any recall of the events that originally encoded them. They serve as a template for how we perceive the world and how we react to later occurrences. Is the world a friendly and nurturing place, or an indifferent or even hostile one? Can we trust other human beings to recognize, understand, and honor our needs, or do we have to shut down emotionally to protect ourselves from feeling vulnerable? These are fundamental questions that we resolve largely our implicit memory system rather than with our conscious mind. When the infant falls asleep after a period of wailing and frustrated cries for help, it is not that she has learned the skill of falling asleep. What has happened is that her brain, to escape the overwhelming pain of abandonment, shuts down. It's an automatic neurological mechanism. In effect, the baby gives up. The short-term goal of the exhausted parents has been achieved, but at the price of harming the child's long-term emotional vulnerability. Encoded in her cortex is an implicit sense of a non-caring universe. In later life, the child will contend with the non-caring universe unwittingly perpetrated by his or her exhausted parents. Television will most likely become his or her babysitter. Long-distance communications will make up the bulk of interpersonal exchanges. And the perfect amalgamations of stratification, commodity fetishism, and alienation, middle and high school, will provoke rebellion and the tumultuous characteristic of modern adolescence. How do the children of unalienated society turn out? What does the society even look like? Well, it just so happens that such societies do in fact exist. Hunter-gatherer societies, although poor and prone to disaster and famine, are not alienated in the Marxian sense. Labor done in those societies is done collectively, and its product is enjoyed by all, thereby giving the worker the satisfaction of not only enjoying the fruits of their labor, but seeing others enjoy it as well. What is the effect on, say, child rearing when alienation is removed? Jared Diamond, a professor of geology at UCLA, observed that most hunter-gatherer and small farming societies do not smack their children. For example, if one, aka pygmy parent, hits an infant, the other parent views this as grounds for divorce. But once we move to societies with primitive concepts of property, such as nomadic or primitive agricultural societies, we find that at the opposite extreme, small herding societies tend to beat their children severely, because a negligent child who leaves the pasture gate open may let valuable livestock escape. Note that the difference between those societies is not their race or culture, but their productive organization. Those societies that have no conception of private property, hunter-gatherer, and those that do, nomadic, herder, and agricultural. In the same article, Diamond goes on to list certain ways in which other child-rearing practices amongst hunter-gatherers differ from one another. Not only are these societies more permissive with their children, says Diamond, but are carried forward-facing to see where they are going, as opposed to carried over the shoulder or backwards in a harness as in Western societies. Mothers also breastfeed for longer periods and do not allow children to cry for any period of time without attention, as opposed to our modern society that employs differing attitudes towards crying children, and largely sees public breastfeeding as a semi-sexual abomination. Indeed, young children are constantly being held, whether by a parent or by another child or sibling. In his recent book, The World Until Yesterday, Diamond, in his chapter on child rearing, calls the discrepancy between primitive high-contact child rearing and our modern low-contact child rearing the ape and antelope system. That is, like apes, primitive children literally clinging to their mothers and are constantly held and attended to, while the modern world, like the deer or antelope, the child is left to its own devices for a while and attended to only briefly. Probably no infant in human history, muses Diamond, was ever left to cry itself to sleep in its own crib or bedroom before 10,000 years ago. Diamond also goes on to state that these children develop into gregarious and precocious youth. By our standards, whose teenage years are not tormented by adolescent revolt or identity crisis, we have investigated our own society, its unhealthy stratification, and have touched upon an unalienated society, but it is possible to transition from one to another. As we know, ideas of property and the production resulting therefrom led to the modern society of primitive communism. But can stratified society regimented by economic and social class transition to a state without exploitation or alienation? A horizontal study, if you will. The research of Dr. Quinn Soplosky and Dr. Lisa Cher Soplosky may shed some light on this question. The couple had spent the better part of three decades studying baboon clans or troops in Kenya. Their study, A Pacific Culture Among Wild Baboons, began after a troop nicknamed Garbage Dump Troop for their propensity for foraging almost exclusively from refuge of a tourist lodge, was devastated by an outbreak of bovine tuberculosis in the site, which killed 46% of the baboons in the troop between 1983 and 86. The interesting factor in this event was that since only the stronger dominant males guarded and enjoyed the fruits of the dump, they were precisely the ones wiped out by the plague. Pre-outbreak, this troop's society, like all baboon troops, was highly stratified and dominated by a cabal of strong males who constantly hounded the smaller males and often acted violently toward females of the troop, leading to the study's author, Robert Sapolsky, in an interview with National Geographic, to describe the baboon society itself as being made up of scheming, backstabbing, and Machiavellian bastards. Naturally, the stress and violent states provoked in the subservient baboon led to a condition of young and a culture of such violence. As in our modern capitalist society, the dominant males represented a class that reinforced a stressful system and absconded with the majority of resources. Like the Whitehall participants, lower-order males from surrounding troops had dangerously high levels of stress and a direct correlation between rank and mortality. In the eerily human fashion, frustrations incurred by lower males were taken out on males of still lower in the hierarchy. And the vast majority of copulations consist of what might be termed rape by us, by higher primates. But after 86, the death of the baboon's ruling class, everything changed. Although strata still remained in this troop post-plague, aggression by the new males is extremely low compared to other troops, which most of it directed at males in the same rung of the hierarchy, and little directed toward lower males. Violence towards females also was no longer observed. Subjects were seen to sit closer together, groom more, share more, decrease levels of stress hormones in all members of the troop. But that isn't all. From the death of the ruling males in 86, the publication of the research in 2004, several generations of baboons had drifted into the troop and pacified males out, as goes the transient nature of baboon troops. But after periods of a few months, new males remarkably socialized to this new cooperative society. Hair pulling had become replaced by grooming, rape by consensual mating. A revolution had occurred in this society. Today, not one original subject remains in the troop, but the pacifist nature passed on by the post-plague generation survives. So if our current arrangement of society is objectively unhealthy, poisons our personal lives and even our posterity, and could be, experts claim, rectified by greater control of the means of production along a horizontal organization, perhaps it is not outside our powers to follow the example of our ancient brothers, as well as our primate cousins, and organize ourselves cooperatively, humanely, and in doing so, dare to be revolutionary.